We live in a society today where in 2018 we have all become aware of, and also some of us have even been affected by Islamic terrorism. We also, especially live in Europe, in the last couple years we have had over a million Muslims walk into our continent. We have a religion in our midst that seems very different, especially in its traditional radical forms, very different to what Europeans are comfortable with and what they have grown to love, their freedoms. And at the moment, we still have religious freedom to a point. Now, that is already changing because we have ideas of Islamophobia. You might have heard that term. A lot of the media likes to use it. And unfortunately, this idea of Islamophobia and people being afraid to critique Islam, it's beginning to diminish our freedoms. So, for example, there was an ex-Muslim friend I had who was arrested by the police in the streets of London because four Muslim youth objected to him, saying that Muhammad killed quite a few hundred men in one day and took their women and children as sex slaves and as wives, he and his men. He was arrested for that, and he came and talked with us, and I said, let me give you the biography of Muhammad, the Sirat Rasulullah. You go into that court, open up the biography of Muhammad according to the earliest Islamic testifiers, just read it verbatim. And as you read it verbatim right there, Muhammad killed 800, or it depends what source you read, but quite a few hundred, 700 to 800 men, and then took their women and children as concubines and slaves, and it was distributed among them. They were distributed among the Muslim men. The court case was thrown out. So we live in an age where people are afraid to speak up, one, because they've seen radical Islam, what it can do. And even though many of our Western media, politicians, even some Christian missionaries, and our dear Muslim friends, of which I have many, even though they're claiming that we are a religion of peace, they say, or Islam is a religion of peace, and terrorism has nothing to do with Islam, unfortunately, people are reading those texts of Islam. They're reading the Quran. They're reading chapter nine of the Quran, the last most authoritative sermon of Muhammad, which calls people to war. They're reading chapter 8, verse 12 of the Quran that says, strike terror into the hearts of the unbelievers. Muslims and non-Muslims are reading chapter 5, verse 33, which is to crucify the Jews and the Christians, or the enemies of Islam, I should say. And so people are reading this and realizing that this radical form that we see in terrorism, there's something legitimate about it according to the text of Islam. So people are aware of that. Or even if people are not, they realize there is an ideology that lives among us, and yet they have this ideology supported by the texts of Islam and the histories of Islam. But then you have our politicians, and you have our maybe high church vicars, you have your rabbis, you have your priests, who are all coming out trying to say a different message. The difficulty is that the reality we experience and we see. And I think there is a political correctness, and not I think, I know there's a political correctness that has permeated especially Western ideas and permeated the church. And so there's a fear, there's a political correctness. Maybe there's fear of being arrested. Maybe there's even fear of death. Probably not likely to happen, but it could happen. And we've seen it happen on our shores. And so we're in a time of much confusion. People don't know what to think. And that's why we have to get down to the truth of the matter. We have to get back, especially as Christians. We have to, if we care for Muslims, and we care for non-Muslims, and we care for Christians, we have to get back to the truth of the matter, which we can find in the history and in the texts of Islam.